Hello friends, in this video we are going to talk about one of the important feature in case of wireless data transfer, that is nothing but security. As it deals with the data integrity, therefore it is considered as an important parameter. So let's discuss about Bluetooth security. So let's begin with the topic. In case of wireless network, as the data transmission takes place through a wireless medium, that means air is used as an interfacing medium. So because of this, it is possible that the data is get attacked by the many types of attack, and due to which the integrity of the data is get reduced. So in order to avoid this, security to the data is required to be provided so that the data is get protected from any of the attack. So in this topic, we are going to talk about the security in case of Bluetooth. So let's start. As discussed, security is an important issue in case of wireless personal area network or in any kind of network, which is whether a wired or wireless network. Data security plays an important role. Bluetooth devices use a combination of personal identification number, which is called as PIN number, and a Bluetooth address. The data encryption can use to further enhance the degree of the Bluetooth security. So with the help of PIN address or with the help of PIN number and Bluetooth device address, as well as the authentication and data integrity, we can enhance the security offered by Bluetooth technology. Bluetooth uses transmission scheme that provides a level of security itself. Frequency hops paired spectrum interface as a radio hops between the channels at fast speed up to 1600 hops per second, which provides same level of security on the data transmission. In addition to low power transmission, prevent the radio signal to propagate too far. As the strength of the signal or power of the signal is very less, therefore the power signals will not transfer or signal will not travel for a longer distance. As we know, the Bluetooth is a short range network, therefore the security offered by Bluetooth required to be very high. The information on the Bluetooth packet payload is encrypted, and the encryption is carried out with the stream cipher E0, which is synchronized for payload. So here the encryption and decryption also plays an important role, because the encryption is carried out in order to prevent any hampering to the data, and therefore it is carried out by using the stream cipher E0. At the receiver, the decryption takes place by using the same cipher so that the data loss can be prevented. Bluetooth security is of paramount importance, as the devices are susceptible to the variety of wireless and networking attacking, which includes denial of service attack, then passive attacks, man in the middle attack, message modification, and resource inappropriation. Whether the network is wired or wireless, these types of attack always affects the data present in the signal. In case of Bluetooth technology or in case of Bluetooth connection, the various types of attack can provide or modify the data that is transmitted between transmitter and receiver. The Bluetooth security must also address more specific Bluetooth related attacks that target known vulnerabilities in Bluetooth implementation and specification. This includes attack against improperly secured Bluetooth implementation, which can provide attacks to the unauthorized access. So if the security is not provided to the Bluetooth network, or if the security is not provided to the wireless personal area network which uses Bluetooth standard, then it may possible that the third party or the unauthorized user may gain access to the network and hamper the data or modify the data that is transmitted or travel across the network. Many users may not believe there is an issue with the Bluetooth security, but hackers may be able to gain access to the information from phone list to more sensitive information that others may hold on the Bluetooth enabled phone or devices. So it is possible for the hackers, or it is possible for the attacker, to gain access to the network and can get the access to the information of the user. So the Bluetooth security is get provided by using three means, and they are, first of all, authentication, second is confidentiality, and third is authorization. So let's see what you mean by authentication is. It is the process to identify the communication device are verified. User authentication is not a part of main Bluetooth security element of the specification. Now in case of authentication, the user required to verify that the user is the valid one and not the unauthorized one. Now, confidentiality is related to the process which prevents information being passively attacked by the attackers and ensure that only the authorized device can have access and can view the data. So confidentiality is related to preventing your data from passive attackers, and it also informs that the person which views the data or the person which gained the access to the network is the authorized one and the valid one. The third is nothing but the authorization. This is the process which prevents access by ensuring that the device is authorized to use a service before enabling it to do so. So before the communication or before the transmission of the data takes place, always the device is required to be authorized so that it is get confirmed that the person or the device is the authorized one and not the unauthorized user. Security measures provided by the Bluetooth specification. The various versions of the specification detail four Bluetooth security mode. Each Bluetooth device operate in one of the four modes. So the four modes are provided by the Bluetooth security in order to provide the prevention of data loss. So the four modes are mode 0, mode 1, mode 2 and mode 3. So mode 1 is nothing but the non-secure mode, and the authentication and encryption functionality is bypassed and the device is susceptible to the hacking Bluetooth device operation in the Bluetooth security mode 1. The device operating like this do not employ any mechanism to prevent other Bluetooth enabled device from establishing the connection. So here the process of authentication, the process of encryption is get bypassed, and therefore it is considered as non-secure mode. And here the device operating like do not employ any mechanism for preventing any other Bluetooth enabled device to form a connection. While it is easy to make a connection, security is an issue. It may be applicable to the short-range devices operating in the area where other device may not be present. Security mode 1 is supported up to Bluetooth 2.0 plus EDR and not beyond. So this mode is applicable only to the version 2 of the Bluetooth, and other than version 2 it is not get applicable, as it is provides a non-secure communication. And it is applicable to the only to those devices which are having a connection or which forms a network in a shorter range. The second mode is nothing but mode 2. Now for this Bluetooth security mode, a centralized security manager controls access to the specific services and devices. Here the centralized architecture is required to be used, where the central control entity manages the various devices and manages the access to the various devices in the Bluetooth network. The Bluetooth security manager maintains the policies for access control and interface with other protocols and device users. So the policies and the various protocols are decided by the control manager, that means the central entity, and according to that the other devices required to be work. It is possible to apply variable trust levels and policies to restrict the access for application with the different security requirement. Even when they operate in the parallel, it is possible to grant access to some services without providing access to other services. So depending upon in which application we are using the Bluetooth mode, or in which application what type of data we are transmitting, based on that the policies may get changed, and it is totally based on the control manager to determine what type of security or what type of policies are required to be applied to the various devices. It may possible that the service or the policies applied to one device may not be applicable to other device. The concept of authorization is introduced in Bluetooth security mode 2. Using this, it is possible to determine if the specific device is allowed to have the access to a specific service or not. So here the authorization takes place, which was not present in the mode 1, because of which the mode 1 becomes a non-secure mode of communication. So because of the authorization, it is possible in the mode 2 to authorize or to verify to which node the certain services are get applied. And the authentication and encryption mechanism are applicable to the Bluetooth security mode 2. They are implemented at the LMP level. And because of that, this type of mode is considered as a secure mode of communication. All Bluetooth devices can support Bluetooth security mode 2. However, version 2.1 and EDR devices can only support backward compatibility for earlier devices. So as this provides authentication as well as encryption of the data, therefore the security provided by this mode is somehow higher than the non-secure mode, that is mode 1. Next is nothing but Bluetooth security mode 3. Now in this mode 3, the device initiates the security process before the physical connection is get established between the device. In this mode, the authentication and encryptions are used for all the connection and to or from the device. So here, from master to slave, as well as from slave to master, the authentication is takes place, as well as the encryption is takes place. The authentication and encryption process uses the separate secret link key that is shared by the pair devices once pairing has been established. So whenever there is a pairing between the two devices, the secret key link is get shared between the two devices, and with the help of that two key link, it is possible to perform the encryption as well as authentication of the device. Therefore, the security provided by this type of mode is very much higher as compared to first and second mode. Bluetooth security mode 3 is only supported in the devices that conforms to Bluetooth 2.0 or earlier. Now, next is nothing but Bluetooth security mode 4, and this mode is introduced at Bluetooth version 2.1 plus EDR. Now, in this mode, the security procedure is get initiated after the setting up of link. Secure simple pairing uses in terms of elliptical curve Diffie-Hellman, that is ECDH, technique for key exchange and link generation. So by using ECDH technique, it is possible to perform the authentication and encryption of the data by sharing the key between the different pairs. The algorithm for the device authentication and encryption algorithm are same those who defined in version 2.0. So they also uses the same secret key link share between the two devices so that the authentication and the encryption decryption can perform. So these are the basically four modes which are provided by the Bluetooth technology for the Bluetooth security. Now, the mode 4 of the Bluetooth security having some special requirements, and the requirements are authenticate link key is required so that the authentication between the two devices can take place, and it will get verified for the user that they are communicating with the valid user, that means the authorized user. Unauthentication link key is required, then no security is required, whatever or not link key is authenticated. Depending upon the simple secure pairing association model used, whether or not a link key is authenticated depend upon the secure simple pairing association model used. Bluetooth security mode 4 is mandatory for communication between the version 2.1 plus EDR devices. Now, after discussing the security modes of Bluetooth, let's find out the common security issues faced by the Bluetooth technology. There are a number of ways in which the Bluetooth security can be penetrated, mostly because they are little secured in the place. The major form of the security problems are as, first is bluejacking. Bluejacking is not a major miscellaneous security problem, though there are certain issues with it, especially as it enables someone to get the data onto the other personal phones, etc. Bluejacking involves sending an V-card message via Bluetooth to other Bluetooth user within a range, that means within a typical range of 10 meter. The aim is that the receptionist will not realize what the message is, and it allows it into their address book. And because of that, the message get automatically opened because they have come from the known contacts. So in this case, that means in case of bluejacking, a V-card message gets sent, and as the user is not aware about the message, it will get automatically stored into the user's phone, and due to which it is possible to get someone's data onto the person's phone. The second type of issue, security issue with the Bluetooth, is nothing but blue bugging. This is considered as a major issue in case of Bluetooth security. This form of Bluetooth security issues allow hackers to remotely access the phone and use its features. So the hacker can have a remote access to someone's phones, and they can use their various features of the phone. This may include placing a call, then it may include sending text message while owner does not realize that the phone has been taken over. So the remotely access to the hacker is possible in case of blue bugging message or in case of blue bugging issue of the security. Now the next type of issue is nothing but car whispering. Now this involves the use of software that allow hackers to send and receive audio to the Bluetooth device, or to send and receive audio from the Bluetooth device for enabling the car stereo system. The next type of attack or the next type of security issues is nothing but the blue mask. This is Bluetooth denial of service attack. where Bluetooth-enabled device is overwhelmed by the miscellaneous request from the hackers. The device receives more number of requests and it will get overwhelmed with the message request, which causes it to be inoperable by its owner and therefore draining the device battery, affecting the continued operation of the device after the attack. So because of this, it is not possible for the user's device to provide a response to the messaging request, and therefore it operate or therefore it provides a deny of service attack to the user's device. So due to the proximity required for the Bluetooth connection, user can move device to a new location and prevent the attack from happening. Because in this case, if the user is in the range or user is in the proximity of the attacker's proximity, then it may possible that the attacker send more and more requests to the Bluetooth device of the user, and the user devices get overwhelmed with the request, and because of that, the battery of the user's phone is get drained out, and it is not possible for the user's phone to have a continue operation, and that results into the denial of service attack. So when the user moves to the next location or other location, it may possible that the attacker may not able to perform the attack, which is called as blue mask. So in order to provide the protection against these type of attacks and these types of vulnerabilities, the manufacturer developed some of the technologies so that they can prevent the Bluetooth device to get hacked or to get affected by the attacker's attack. Then next, let's have a look about the Bluetooth security architecture. So figure shows the Bluetooth security architecture, which consists of link manager or link controller. Then HCI is present and the L2 cap is present. So here the layered architecture is basically used in order to provide the security architecture of Bluetooth. The dotted line is used for indicating the registration process, and the solid arrows are used for indicating the query. Device database and service database are used for providing the query and registration information, and the security manager is used for providing the entire security process of the Bluetooth device. So let's understand this architecture in detail. So in the architecture, security manager plays an important role as it stores the information about the security of the services and security of the devices. It decides on acceptance of the access or disconnection and requires authentication and encryption if needed. So it basically performs the operation of authentication. It performs the operation of encryption whenever it is needed. It is also responsible for disconnection as well as acceptance of the access or disconnection of the access. The security manager also initiates setting up the trusted relationship and peering. It basically handles the PIN code of the users. Then the Bluetooth has several different security levels that can be defined for the devices and services. The device can have two trust levels. That means trusted and untrusted are the two trust levels supported by the device. The trusted level required a fixed and trusted relationship, and it has unrestricted access to all the services as the device has the previously authenticated. If the service manager have the information about the device, and if the service manager already followed the process of authentication with the device, then the device can have the trusted level, and in that trusted level the devices get unrestricted to all the type of services and all the type of accesses. Now the second trust level is nothing but the untrusted trust level. Now the untrusted devices do not have the fixed relationship, and its access to the services is limited. It is not possible for the device to get access to all the services, and a new device is labeled as unknown device, and it is always untrusted. When the new device enters into the Bluetooth network, or when the new device enters into any of the PicoNet, then it is considered as an untrusted device, because the device manager do not know any information about the device. The device manager do not contain the information regarding with the PIN and device address of the device. Therefore, it is considered as untrusted device, and therefore, because of that, the device having limited access to the limited services. Then the next part in the architecture is nothing but the security level of the service. The security level of the service is basically defined by three attributes. The first one is the authorization required. In this, access is only guaranteed automatically to the trusted device or the untrusted device after authorization process takes place. So even if the device is untrusted, then the device manager follows the authentication process or the authorization process in order to make the device authorized, and after that only it is possible for the device to gain an access to the various type of services. Then the second attribute for the security level of service is nothing but authentication required. Before connecting to application, the remote device requires to be authenticated so that the service must come to know that the device is the authorized one and the validated one. The next is nothing but the encryption required. The link must be changed to the encrypted mode before accessing to the service is possible, because when the encryption is performed, the data is get converted into the ciphertext so that it will not get modified by any of the attacker, and therefore it is possible to maintain the integrity of the data and successful communication can be takes place. On the lowest level, the service can be set to be accessible to all the devices. When highest level of security is basically needed, then the service required both authentication, that means an authorization, and the trusted device has access to the service, but the untrusted device needs some manual authentication. As we know, the device manager contains the information about the trusted device. Therefore, the device can have access to all the services when the service level or the level of security needed is higher. But when the device is unauthorized one, then the access to the services is limited to that particular device. And the unauthorized device or the untrusted device requires a manual authentication. Now next is nothing but the link key. The all security transactions between two or more than two parties are handled by 128-bit random number, and that is called as link key. It is basically used in the authentication process and it is used as a parameter when for the encryption purpose. Lifetime of the link key is depend upon whether it is semi-permanent or temporary key. Now the semi-permanent key is nothing but the key that can be used after the current session is over to authenticate the Bluetooth units that share, and the temporary keys are commonly used in the point to multipoint connection when the same information is transmitted to the several reception. That means when the message is a broadcast type of message, then in that case temporary key is used. That means the same information is going to get received by all the receivers, so in that case the temporary key is used. But when the message is intended to one particular user only, then in that case semi-permanent key is used. Then next link key is nothing but the four link keys. A unit key that is represented by KA is derived at the installation of the Bluetooth device for unit A. The combination key KAB is generated for new pair of each Bluetooth device and used for further security whenever it is needed. The second key is nothing but the master key, which is represented by K master. It is a temporary key and it is used whenever the master device wants to transmit the information to more than one device at once. So basically when the message is broadcast one and when the master wants to transmit this message to more than one device, then this key is used, which is called as key master and represented by K master. The next is nothing but the initialization key, and it is represented by KINIT, and it is used in the initialization process and it is formed from random number, L octet pin code and device address of the claimant unit. So the receiver device address and the receiver's octet pin is used for forming the initialization key, and it is basically used for initializing the communication or initializing the process. The next key is nothing but the encryption key, and it is generated from the current link key. It is 96-bit key used as a cipher offset number that is represented by COF and 128-bit random number. Now COF is based on the authenticated cipher offset that is represented by ACO, which is generated during the authentication process. Next is nothing but PIN code. So basically PIN is a number which can be either fixed or it can be selected by user and employed to enhance the security of the system. So whenever the pairing of Bluetooth takes place, the PIN number is required to be entered into the phone or into the device so that the authentication and authorization of the user can take place. The length of the PIN code can vary between 1 to 16 octave, whereas regular 4-bit code is sufficient for certain application. But enhanced security requirements required longer code. So depending upon the level of security, the PIN size or the we can say the size of PIN code is get vary. Now let's have a look about the process called as authentication. So authentication starts by issuing the challenge to another device, which in turn send a response back, which is based on the receiving challenge by the receptionist. So in order to perform the authentication, first of all, the device required to send a challenge, which is called as authentication challenge, to the receiver. After receiving that challenge, the device send back a request, which is called as received challenge request, or which received channel signal back to the transmitter. The device address, which is represented by BD_ADR, and the link key shared between the devices. So after transmitting the and receiving the signals of challenge, the device transmit the device address and the link key is get shared between them. Without knowing the PIN, one unit cannot log on to another unit if the authentication is activated. So in order to perform the activation, or in order to perform, or in order to have a communication between two devices, the PIN number is required to be known. Now Bluetooth uses a challenge response scheme in which claimant knowledge of a secret key is checked through a two-move protocol using symmetric secret key. So here basically the claimant required to know the shared key, and that means the secret key, and the knowledge about the secret key is checked by using the two-move protocol. As a side product, the authenticated ciphering offset, that is ACO, is computed and stored in both the devices and later used to generate the data encryption key that will be employed between the pair of devices. So along with the two-move protocol, the authenticated ciphering offset, that is ACO, is get calculated and it get stored into the devices, and after in the process it is get used for generating the encryption key. It verifies who is at the other end of the link. So by using the two-move protocol and ACO, it is possible to verify that who is present on the other side of the link. In Bluetooth, this is achieved by authentication process based on the store link key or by using a pairing process. To meet the requirements of the availability of the services without user intervention, authentication performs after determining what security level of the service is required. So in order to provide the different services to the user, or in order to obtaining the information about the different requirements of the availability of the service without the user knowledge, the authentication is get performed for determination of what security level is required for the operation. Authentication cannot perform when the ACL link is established. The authentication is performed when the connection request to the service is submitted. So only when the device wants a service from the user, or only when the device requires service from the particular node, and after that only the authentication is get performed. So in order to perform this, it requires to follow certain steps, and the steps are: first one, the connect request to L2 cap is sent. After that, the L2 cap request access from the security manager. Then the security manager requires the service database. Fourth process is nothing but the security manager inquires the device database, that means the device address, device PIN number. Next is, if required, the security manager enforces the authentication and encryption process. If the device is trusted, then there is no need of authentication and encryption. If the device is untrusted, then the security manager requires to perform the authentication and encryption process. The sixth step is, the security manager grants the access and L2 cap continue to set up the connection. So after getting approval from the security manager, the L2 cap performs the, or it set up the connection and performs the data transfer. So this is what about the figure shows authentication process. First, here the security manager plays an important role. If it requires to perform the authentication and encryption, then only it performs it. Otherwise, in case of trusted device, it grants the access, and after authenticating and encrypting the data, it will inform L2 cap to perform the or set up the connection. So the first is nothing but HCI send a request to L2 cap regarding with the connection. After receiving that request, the second step is the L2 cap informs to the security manager. Security manager first checks the service database, whether the device is trusted or not, whether it contains the information about the PIN and device address or not. If it is present, then it will again check the device database for the same thing. On receiving the request from HCI, it will provide or after performing authentication and encryption, it will grant access to L2 CCAP, and L2 CCAP then establish a connection and connect it to the application. So this process basically informs the process of authentication. Now next is to discuss the challenge response scheme in Bluetooth, and for that we require to consider a diagram. Here we are considering two units, that is unit A and unit B. Unit A acts as a verifier and unit B acts as a claimant. A unit send A, basically a unit A that is a verifier, send a random input denoted by AU, RANDA. That is a random number with authentication code denoted by E1 to unit B. So here the unit A send a request or a random number, that is AURANDA, to a claimant unit, and it is basically a random number unit. The unit B then calculate signed response, which is represented by SRES. So in response to the random number, the unit B, that means the claimant, send a signed in response, that is represented by SRES. Now unit B calculate SRES and returns the result to unit A. Unit A will derive SRES and authenticate unit B if the SRES of the unit A and SRES of the unit B matches with each other. The next topic for the discussion is nothing but authorization. Now, when one device is allowed to access the other, the concept of trust comes into existence. Because whenever the device is trusted, or whenever the user knows that the person who is connecting to it is a verified one, is the trusted one, then only the security is get achieved in case of Bluetooth or in case of any type of wireless network. Trusted devices are allowed to access the services because the information about the trusted device regarding PIN, Bluetooth device number is known to the security manager, and therefore it is possible for the trusted device to have access to all the types of services. Untrusted device may require authorization based on the user interaction before accessing the services. So as discussed earlier, only the untrusted device do not have access, or it have a limited access to the limited amount of services, and therefore it requires to perform the authentication and authorization manually so that it can gain access to all the services and it can gain access to all other type of communication purpose. There are two kinds of device trust level. First one is trusted device, the device having a fixed relationship and has a trusted and unrestricted access to all the services. And second is untrusted device, which is not authenticated, or if the device has been previously authenticated and link key is stored, but the device is not marked as a trusted device in the device database. Then in that case also the device is considered as an untrusted device. Unknown device is also called as untrusted device. No security information is available for this device for the service, and requirement for authentication, authorization and encryption are set independently. So in case of untrusted device, even if the device is previously trusted and link key is stored, but the device is not marked as a trusted device, then also it is considered as an untrusted device, and it is required to perform the authentication, authorization and encryption so that it can gain access to all the services without any restriction. The access requirement defines three levels of security. The first one is service that required authentication or authorization. Second is the service that required authentication only. And third one is the service open to all the devices. So in case of the services that requires both authentication and authorization, they provide automatic access only to the trusted devices. The untrusted device requires to perform authentication and authorization independently. The second type of security level is nothing but the service that required authentication. So in this case, only authorization is not necessary for the untrusted device. And third type of service is nothing but the services open to all the devices. Authentication is not required. No access approval is required before services get granted. So here, whether the device is trusted one or untrusted one, irrespective of that, the services are open to all the type of devices. Default security level is defined to serve the need of legacy application. This default policy will be used unless other settings are found in the security database related to the services. So on the basis of these three levels, the services get available or services get access to the various type of trusted and untrusted devices. Now, there are certain limitations on the Bluetooth security. So, the limitations are, from the security point of view, Bluetooth has its own limitation and support solution which are not totally satisfied the requirements of the security. First, the authentication scheme only authenticate the devices, not the user. And if the feature is needed, it has to be accomplished with the assistant of some application level security manager. That means here only the authentication of the device takes place and authentication of user is not takes place. If we require authentication of user, then we require to combine the mechanism with the application level mechanism. The second limitation is Bluetooth does not define separate authorization for each service and can be applied in the Bluetooth architecture without changing the protocol stack. But changes in the security manager and the registration process would be necessary. So in the second limitation, the separate authorization for each service is not provided by the Bluetooth technology. There will be no changes in the protocol stack of the Bluetooth, only the changes in the device manager or in the registration process and security managers are required. Presently, Bluetooth allow access control only at the connection setup and the access check can be asymmetric, but once the connection is established, the data flow is bidirectional in principle and there is no way to enforce the uniform or unidirectional traffic. So definitely, in nowadays, the Bluetooth connection provides a security only at the connection setup time and not after the connection is get established. Once the connection is get established, the bidirectional data transfer can be performed. We are using the Bluetooth technology for connecting to the handset. We are using Bluetooth technology for connecting keyboard to the PCs and for transferring data to other phones from other phone. So there are some techniques or there are some tips that can be used in order to prevent the data loss in the Bluetooth data transmission and to provide security to the Bluetooth device. So the tips for Bluetooth security are: the discoverable mode on your device only meant to be used to pair two Bluetooth enabled device. When the pairing process is done, the discoverable mode can be turned off as the device should remember each other. So after establishing the connection, we need to turn off the discoverable mode, because when the connection is get established, the device get known to each other and therefore the pairing, after pairing, it is possible to establish the connection. Refrain from communicating or transmitting sensitivity and personal information using Bluetooth enabled device as it might be sniffed. So avoid to transmit the personal information or avoid to transmit the sensitive information by using a Bluetooth devices. Use strong passkey that is randomly generated when pairing Bluetooth devices. And never enter passkey when unexpectedly prompted for them. So always be required to use the strong passkey only when the pairing request from known Bluetooth comes, and we require to use the passkey which is randomly generated. Maintain physical control of the device at all times. Remove lost or stolen devices from the paired device list. Avoid accepting attachment or application received on your phone or device if you were not expecting it, no matter how legitimate it is. If your device asked to pair and you didn't initiate the pairing, denied it and check that your discoverable setting is set to off or hidden. So it may possible that the attacker send more and more number of requests to your device or more and more number of message in the form of vCard message, which results into denial of service or blue mask message. So to avoid it, never ever allow the device to become a discoverable and never receives the message which are obtaining from the unknown person. So these are the certain tips by using which we can protect the Bluetooth security or we can protect the data by using these tips. So I hope you understand this topic of Bluetooth security, as the security plays an important role in any form of communication because it deals with the data transmission and reception. If the unauthorized person gets an access to the network or if the unauthorized person get an access to the data, then it may hamper the user's integrity and user's personal space. So I hope you understand this topic of Bluetooth security. So thank you very much for watching this video. Stay tuned to Ekeeda. Subscribe Ekeeda. Thank you.